Welcome to the TinyBox Dialogues. This series was created to share the knowledge of our experts using real examples from real people with real stories. Welcome to TinyBox Dialogues. Today we are speaking to Lukasz Kos, an internationally recognized and renowned architect who has received many accolades, and I have to read them because I can't remember them all. So best of year by Interior Design Magazine, New York City, Restaurant and Bar Design Awards finalist in London, featured in Taschen, Vogue, Architectural Digest, Giorgio Armani, Mercedes-Benz, and I'm sure the list goes on and on and on, Lukasz. Please, would you take a moment to introduce yourself and say hi to our audience?
Hello, Raj, and thank you for inviting me for this talk. It's an honor and a great privilege to be speaking to you about this. I'm a registered architect in Canada, kind of traveled the world, worked all over the place, Toronto, LA, Shanghai, Warsaw, and London now. So I'm based in Warsaw and starting to do work in London as well as Poland. And I basically specialize in high-end residential projects, hospitality work, mainly restaurants. I've done some hotel work as well in the past. Mm-hmm. You've mentioned a lot of the publications that I've been included in, as well as awards that I've been awarded internationally for my work. So yes, the list is quite extensive. I won't brag about it too much. I was educated in the University of Toronto, the Faculty of Architecture there. That's where I earned my master's degree. I really cut my teeth, though, at Frank Gehry's office in Los Angeles, where I worked on a number of very complex high-end projects, including Louis Vuitton flagship, Tiffany & Company flagship. There was a Mandarin Oriental five-star hotel flagship as well, and a bunch of other sort of very high-end projects at Gehry's office. And really, the lessons that I learned there, I've taken with myself in my own independent career moving forward after Frank Gehry's office. And I think the sort of success is a clear indicator of how much impact that office really did have on me as a learning experience.
So you know that I'm Canadian and I've lived in Toronto and I'm a huge fan of Frank Gehry. So I was always very impressed when you told me that you worked with Frank Gehry. The first place I visited when I came to Germany was in Dusseldorf. He has some stuff on the waterfront there. Yeah, beautiful pieces. So yeah, very much appreciate you giving us that background. And we do like to say at the dialogues, we like to bring in the experts. So it's nice that you've given us some of that, shown your integrity that you are definitely the expert to be on this call. Now, I'm going to jump right in and say this is the first time we've had an exclamation point in our title, Hire a Designer, exclamation point. Why did you land on that title for our talk in particular?
Yeah, I think because before we agreed to do this, we had our little chat. And I think the idea was, really, why are designers and architects necessary, or an asset actually to any business investment that requires sort of brick and mortar establishment? And the exclamation point really comes from a recent experience that I'm having. I've been invited to consult on a restaurant project in London that was already well underway. Mm-hmm. And is way behind schedule and is way over budget. And the only reason is because they didn't hire a designer or an architect. They thought they could do it all by themselves. Mm-hmm. And it's a mess. So really, I think that's the catalyst for our conversation here, is why are designers and architects not only needed for creating beautiful spaces that clients will want to come back to, but how are they going to help you with your ROI and make sure you don't blow your budget on silly things that designers and architects can do easily?
I think that's really what jumped out at me when we first had that conversation, is that people really underestimate the importance of design in these projects. They undervalue the effectiveness, the impactfulness of design. We're going to take it from a different perspective of human interaction versus ROI, but I think that it is a provocative title for a reason. And why do you think that is, that people are just underestimating that design is needed for a new restaurant or building? Is it, is it just hubris? Is it ego? What is it?
Well, I personally think there's an underestimation for sure, but I think there's a negative stereotype associated with interior designers and architects. Hollywood doesn't help. There's that terrible movie from 2016 called The Architect. It really just paints the architect in the worst sort of negative stereotypes that are out there. Mm-hmm. If that's the sort of public misconception about what architects interior designers do, then I'm not surprised that they may want to shy away from working with an architect or a designer.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense.
But yeah, but what they really do underestimate is, you know, yes, we do provide a service that allows your space or your, you know, your business to have a design quality that, you know, is competitive in the marketplace, that'll draw clients to your business. But, you know, that's really just like 10% of the project is the sort of fun part, creating the beautiful space. 90% of what we do is really kind of mundane and boring. We're there to like manage the project, make sure it comes in on budget, it's specified properly, and then it's executed on time in the time allotted to us. And that really is an expertise and really does require experience for, you know, to be able to do that. And I think a lot of clients think they can do it themselves, and a lot of do. I'm not naysaying clients that go after it and they do it, and you know, they take the time to do that. But I think a client's time is better spent doing the things that they're good at, which is, you know, building up their business, as opposed to taking calls from contractors 10, 15 times a day, or, you know, material suppliers 10, 15 times a day. You know, it's a huge distraction from what they're supposed to be doing, which is building up their business.
I find that very surprising, actually. I'm glad you share that, because I think that's also a stereotype that's perpetuated, is that the 10% of the actual picking things and doing the pretty work, right? Whereas now you're talking about it, it's the same reason that people need admin assistance, because you cannot manage every single call on your own. But I love that you have the final say and you can be a core component of the project team for the building. So that's fantastic. I'm going to jump a little bit into the brand itself, and then we can come back to some of those ROI issues. So now, you said to me once that designers are experts in human experience. That was the quote. And I really love that quote. But I wanted to ask you on the dialogue why you describe it that way and why you think that's important.
Well, I mean, if let's just take a restaurant, for example. I mean, the experience of a restaurant isn't just the food, right? And even let's just take the food at a restaurant. The experience of the food isn't just the taste of the food, but it's the whole presentation. How's the food composed? You know, what's the taste balance? Is it too salty? Is it not, you know, is it too sweet? The lighting on the food, is the lighting, you know, appropriately calibrated to the type of food that's being presented at that restaurant? That's just the food. We're not even talking about like the table ergonomics, the chair ergonomics, the height of the ceiling, the width of the space between people at the table. There are just countless elements that go into creating a space that is comfortable, is exceptional, creates an environment that clients want to come back to. And also not only just come back to, but then promote through word of mouth. You know, that investment in a fantastic space for your restaurant is really an investment in your, you know, on your ROI at the end of the day.
I bet, you know what, I actually, the first time I was introduced to how important that is, it was working at McDonald's, and I found out there was an interior designer that came in, and it turns out that they've actually designed it ergonomically and colors and lighting on the food so that you don't want to stay indoors, so they can have huge turnover. So that's why the walls are green, because that's actually not an appealing color to have within the restaurant. So that was the first time I was ever introduced to it. So I can very much attest that this is a big deal. It's a very big deal. So, you know, when we're talking about customers and we're talking about humans as customers, there's been a lot of pushback, because I think customers are becoming more attuned to what's happening in the marketplace, and they want to be treated like human beings. They want to be treated individually, and they want special attention, and they're willing to wait now for packages, not overnight from Amazon, but willing to wait for whatever their product is, so that it's local and sustainable. And there's so many components to it. We are reverting back to personal and special interactions, and I guess I'm curious how design helps with that. Like, what do people forget about this human aspect when they start their building process? Even can you share even a story with us about, you know, when there was a bad design for humans?
Sure. Well, I think, I mean, not to like dwell on McDonald's, I think McDonald's is an example of a company that, you know, that was a strategy in the past. I think they've changed their strategy. Mm-hmm. Recently, they're now retrofitting their spaces to be more comfortable. I mean, here in in Europe. I mean, there's like now lounges with deep seats, you know, leather couch lounge wow. type seating in the cafe. So it's they've realized that it's, you know, they're competing with a lot of healthy choices that are out there, which is a big part and a big component of restaurant design. And, you know, the restaurant business is, you know, the fast food industry really is moving towards these sort of healthy options. And as a result, their interiors have to be less plasticky, more comfortable, and more enjoyable. So
right.
moving past McDonald's, you know, anecdotally, just living in Shanghai for 4 years and practicing there, huge, I mean, city of 25 million people, 90% of them eat out, right? Like it's the restaurant industry is massive there. Wow. Tons of food. I mean, I'm exaggerating with 90% probably, but you know, eating on the go is a big part of the culture in Asia. And, but then like evening dinners and, you know, casual fine dining or even fine dining becomes just as competitive because you've got that mass of people wanting to find that next great dining experience. So that's, you know, Shanghai is a kind of extreme example where you've got such a massive amount of people. London really isn't that much different with what, 10, 12 million people, still very competitive. And if you want to compete in that market as a restaurant designer, you really do need to provide a space that people will want to come back to, feel comfortable in, that they'll want to tell their friends about and brag about, oh, that they've been to this great new spot, amazing food, amazing interior. You know, social media, we could go on about social media, about selfies and, you know, TikToks and food photos. That's all.
Better have good light for photos in the restaurant.
Exactly. That's a whole other topic that we could spend, you know, another hour discussing. But all of those components, you know, again, are conceived somewhere. And if you're working with a designer that has that experience of creating those special experiences for clients, it's going to help with the success of your project.
Yeah, absolutely. And then the loyalty and commitment comes from that, right? That's really interesting. You know, and maybe that's where you segued into restaurants. Was it through Shanghai? Because you used to work on other high-end buildings, or you have in the past. I remember you saying that you've worked on a house in the Hamptons. So, you know, what brought you deeper into the restaurant business? Is there something in particular that you love about it?
Yeah, so, I mean, definitely I started off really working on residential projects, high-end residential projects. My first project was actually when I was still a student at the University of Toronto. I won a competition for a three-story treehouse that got built by a patron of architecture in Toronto. So I was very lucky and privileged to, you know, be able to participate in that competition, win it, and then have that project sort of published all over the world. And, you know, which really was a kind of slingshot for my career. That's how I ended up in Frank Gehry's office. And from there, you know, the kind of sky was the limit. And I tended to really just attract clients that were looking for something special, specific, unique to their needs. There's a project, Villa in the Hamptons, mm-hmm. you know, villas here in Europe and, you know, in Poland, there's a lot of very high net worth individuals in Poland looking for investment in residential projects currently, which is something that we're working on. And, but the restaurants actually came about in Shanghai. Yeah, there was just so much competition for creating kind of fantastic dining experiences that it was a natural sort of segue from what we were doing, which was these sort of great experiences on a residential personal level, transferring that, you know, conveying that in a more public space, a commercial space that depends on clients feeling comfortable, welcome, wanting to spend money, you know, wanting to entertain their friends, bring their friends, show their friends this new place that they've discovered that nobody else knows. You know, there's a lot of ego involved in the sort of cachet of knowing a new place. And, you know, that's what we help develop for our clients is that cachet.
Well, we know that restaurants, I mean, they have a very difficult chance of success. I mean, isn't there a really horrible statistic about how many restaurants fail within the first year? So clearly design has an impact on that. And what I do love about, you know, you say that it started in Shanghai is that you moved to Warsaw right at a time where there was a lot of investment in restaurants as well. And I remember going there because my sister had lived there at one point, and there was this incredible, like almost like timeout market that had been developed, and it was incredible. And I know you've worked on restaurants there too. London is always in the market for new restaurants, so of course. But yeah, did you find that all that experience from your global experience that actually was the perfect timing to come into Warsaw and help them develop their restaurant scene?
Absolutely. Although I have to admit, there's a lot of talented designers here, and the market is quite competitive in terms of design. Lots of fantastic designers working in Poland, and they're working all over Europe as well. There definitely is a strong design culture in this country that maybe isn't well publicized around the world. But yeah, Living here, I've been sort of humbled by a lot of projects that I've walked into. Really, they're doing it at a very exceptional high level. And I think that has to do with the fact that Warsaw is a not only the capital city, but it's also the capital city. It's where the banks are. It's where the major international businesses have their headquarters. The hotels here are, far above the rest of Poland, I would say. So there's, there's a lot of capital that's coming through the city. And as a result of that capital, there's a demand for sort of excellence and, again, human experience that is at an international level. And I think, it's a great city for that.
Actually, that's a great segue from the capital, because that brings us to the ROI and how we were discussing the financial impact when we underestimate the importance of the design element in these projects. Why does a designer help people maximize their ROI and build their brand recognition? Let's come back to, what's the level of loss that you've seen that could have been avoided, and how could it have been avoided? Because to be honest, a lot of people think any architectural project or any building project always double the budget and double the time. That's kind of the standard thing that you hear often, whether it's your house or your restaurant or whatever it is. So I guess I just really want to dig into why is the ROI going to be improved, and where have you done that before? Have you got a story for us on where you've seen that it saved money, it saved time, it created efficiencies, etc.?
Well, with restaurant projects, we haven't doubled or extended the schedule by two at all ever. In fact, we've usually been pretty close to budget or under budget with the restaurants. With the residential projects, that's another story, because as you start building, as the thing starts coming to life, it's really the doubling of the schedule and the doubling of the budget is client driven, where they've agreed to a concept, all the working drawings are complete, the contractors have priced everything, they go in and they start building things, and then the client says, oh, I would really love to upgrade this, I would really love to change this to this more lavish material.
And let that be a warning to any listeners. It's on you.
yeah. And usually the stuff that they want to bring back in was part of the concept, and they took it out because it was going to be too expensive. But then once they see it in the space, they end up spending the money anyway. So it's
I got to tell you, Lukasz, to be honest, that sounds like every single project that I've ever managed. So I totally understand.
Right. So I'm defending, the practice of architects and interior designers.
Love it.
Really, we're here as, a service provider for our clients. And we're here to help them, guide them in the direction they want to go to. If they want to spend more money, they want to take twice as long, we're here to help them do that as well. If they want to do it, cheap and cheerful and as quickly as possible, we're more than capable of doing that. It's really at the behest of the client what they want to accomplish.
Mm-hmm. And with
but with restaurants, going back to this anecdote, this project in London, there's this client has done smaller projects by themselves in the past, and when you're talking about 30 or 40 seats in a restaurant, that's manageable if you know what you're doing. This new restaurant that they're opening up, 150 seats, so five times the size, in a new residential development at street level, with high foot traffic, high street traffic, very demanding developer with very demanding sort of branding requirements and quality requirements, as well as scheduling requirements. And I think that's where you start to switch over into needing a professional interior designer to help you through all of that project management, the project management aspect of the project. So you can have all of the great fun and design upfront, the 10%, which will help you develop that so that, you know, the building management project is manageable within that budget and that the timeline. So that's where we come in as experts, really. And I think with this client, they thought that they could just, you know, multiply their efforts times X without the sort of knowledge of what that entails. And they've really dug themselves into a hole because, they've started things.
Yeah.
They've started working with a professional contractor as well, which has their own business model, which is kind of an industry standard business model. And if you're not aware of what that industry standard business model is, you are going to have a really difficult time shoehorning yourself into that on the go. So that's really what we bring in as interior designers and architects, is understanding of the sort of business model of the construction industry that's quite standardized, and providing that service for the client within that model so that it comes in on budget, on time.
I got to say, during the MBA, we were asked to do a project where we had to design a restaurant. Now, this was like in terms of profitable revenue. And what we discovered was very quickly in this modeling exercise is that the number of people at a bar versus a table versus the space of either of those has a huge impact on your revenue model, right? So that was, again, the first time I'd been introduced to just simply knowing how many bar stools you should have at a bar in a restaurant is a big impact on what's happening overall for the profitable business, right? So I really love that concept of bringing the designer, because they'll get a sense of the space and know how you can maximize your revenue, I would assume.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. It's part of the business model of that the client has for their restaurant. So if it's a bar driven establishment, so alcohol driven establishment, then then you put weight on the bar and making the bar the center of the experience. You know, if it's more about fine dining or casual fine dining, the bar plays the secondary aspect to, you know, the actual dining experience of the restaurant. So it's really about, you know, finding that balance of what you want in from your business model for the restaurant, where you want to generate your income, and then you build your design around that, for sure.
In this particular case, I'm sure that with the foot traffic that's going by, this is a very huge impact on whether people can actually get a table. I'm sure there's lots that goes into that, but fantastic. Thank you so much. I want to just drill us a bit forward into the future. And we know that people are starting to invest more in physical assets. We know the building projects are going up again. I get emails all the time from Toronto about condo buildings going up, in fact. We see that there's a lot of demand out there right now for design. Are you seeing that reflected, from the people that you know in your community? And when should they add the designer to the process, if that's the case?
When should you add the design to the process? Probably the sooner the better. You can always, consult with a designer, architect, in the kind of pre-design phase where you're developing the business model for your establishment, for example. Mm-hmm. We're more than happy to talk to you about what your project is, give you some pointers, and, allow you to build that business model up before you're actually ready to engage us for the actual design, right? In the kind of pre-design phase, we're happy to, talk about layouts, bar seat counts versus table seat counts, foot traffic, the ratio of the kitchen to the dining room, even things, even the most mundane things, fire exit requirements, right, in building code. I mean, these are things that people don't think about, but have huge impacts. Imagine going through all of the sort of design by yourself, going to city council for approval, and they say, well, your fire exits are not to code. Here's where you have to create new corridors, which chop up your kitchen in half, and your whole design is out the door. You start from scratch. So again, that 90%, super critical for the project management, that 90%, super critical for the success of your project and that return on investment. And again, we're here to do the part that we're experts at, allowing the clients to be experts at what they do, which is develop their business. I would never tell a lawyer what to write in a legal document, right? Or I would never tell a doctor halfway through a surgery, you know, look down in the stomach and tell him which thing to suture up, right? Like, there's an expertise in every profession that we respect. And I think clients need to realize that the designers and architects really do bring a high level of professional expertise into any project.
A side note, I know you're not going to be expecting these kind of questions, but a side note on that is, you know, the level of autonomy that's needed for you to do a good job in that design project. Is it something that, you know, you work closely, obviously, with the owner, but you do need a level of autonomy, right? Because if you've got to answer these 30 calls a day from whomever, then that's something, like, trust is a big aspect, is it not?
Trust is a big aspect, you know, yeah, autonomy. You know, we're autonomy. It's a good point. There are clients that are more demanding and there are clients that are, you know, more hands-off. And, you know, we work with both types of clients. I've worked with clients that are, you know, we're literally laying out kitchens with them. We're laying out, you know, the pastry display cases. And those are clients that I actually do appreciate working with because they have a vision. Yeah. They just don't know how to express it, right?
Or make it a reality, yeah.
Or make it a reality.
Yeah.
And the passion. So we really actually do appreciate those kinds of clients that bring certain parameters into a project that we can then bounce ideas off of and then work within those parameters to create a kind of exceptional experience.
Fantastic. Well, we are just about out of time. So I just want to give you a moment to share, you know, your final takeaways, because I think there is a lot to be said for bringing in a designer, not for the 10% of the design, but 90% of the project management. Being a project manager, I really appreciate that. But if there's any final takeaways that you'd like to leave the listeners with, that would be fantastic.
Yeah, I think we talked about the design process and the project management process. I think the other thing that we need to, that clients should be aware of is the sort of PR spin-offs after the project is open and people are coming to the project. If you've got a beautifully designed space, it's going to photograph fantastically. You're going to have magazines and publications dying to publish your restaurant. It's basically free PR. So a great design is an investment also in the you know, in the sort of marketing of your project, not only locally but globally. I mean, there are like design and architecture tourists that'll literally fly halfway across the world just to sit at a restaurant because it's been published in certain magazines, right? So that does attract a certain level of you know, that should be something that the clients actually do consider when hiring the designer is, do they have a track record of producing projects that do get that PR after opening.
Whether we get published, you mean, in even architectural magazines, etc.
Online blogs, design magazines, you know, awards, all of these things are build cachet for any given project. And that cachet translates into, you know, dollar signs, pound signs, euro signs.
I love that you have to cover all the places that you've lived in the world with that one.
Yens, sorry, RMBs.
A final question from me. Is there a particular project that you're really proud of that perhaps we can even suggest to the listeners that they should be attending, or a particular place that you love even if you didn't design it?
People have a love-hate relationship, but it's not something I designed. People have a love-hate relationship with this restaurant interior. It's a sketch in London.
I'm writing it down.
Well, the first time I saw it, it blew my mind. And I think it's just a beautiful design. They've recently changed the materials and the fabrics. So updated it. Because I think the old one was already like 6 or 7 years old.
Yeah.
And they've changed the curation of the gallery inside. So it's a restaurant inside of an art gallery, essentially. Wow. Or it's a restaurant with a curated gallery space. Okay. And so, you know, they've kind of recently updated it. It's still awesome, right? So it's one of my favorites.
That's another point as well. You got to update your restaurant interior, so you might as well have a designer who can do it for you and with you in the future as well.
Absolutely.
Fantastic.
And if you do it right, you don't have to close your restaurant down for months. It could be a matter of weeks.
That's a very good point. So there again, with the ROI, there you go.
Open sooner, make money faster. Yep.
Fantastic. Okay, well, thank you very much for speaking to us about the design element. And you've heard it here first, folks, hire a designer. This audio will be shared on Spotify. This video will be shared on YouTube. Information on where to find Lukasz, and if you want to hire him, will be underneath both. So thanks very much for joining, and thank you, Lukasz. Take care. Thank you.
Really appreciate it, Raj.